Thank you.
Thank you.
Can you talk a little bit about your path to the firm and your path to CEO?
Sure. So I grew up in Westchester County, you know, outside of New York City. I went to public high school in Westchester, and I went to Hamilton College, and I studied political science and American history, real liberal arts education. The world was very different in 1984 when I was graduating. You know, I worked at a summer camp during the summers when I was in college. I actually had one job during one year during college. After my freshman year in college, I worked in finance. I went and worked at a Merrill Lynch brokerage office that was here in New York City as a cold caller. And I spent my summer, I had a list, it was a zip code list, and I had to make 100 cold calls a day off that list to try to get people to open an account at Merrill Lynch. And I did it for 8 weeks, so I was making 500 calls a week, and I got 2 meetings and opened 1 account. And they said that that was highly successful. But you think about an agonizing summer. And I remember after the first week going home to my father and saying, I can't do this for the summer. Yeah. And he said to me, yes, you can. You committed to do this. You know, find a way to make it into a game, make it more exciting. And it was a super experience because it actually taught me that you could pick up the phone and call anyone. Mm. And, you know, it became a game to see how long you could keep them on the phone. But it was brutal. But I think a foundational experience. So anyway, I graduated from college, and I came to New York because most of my friends were coming to New York. I got a job. I interviewed at Goldman Sachs. I didn't get a job. That was the first of 3 times I interviewed at Goldman Sachs. The third time was a charm. I interviewed for a job at Goldman Sachs, but I got a job at a bank called the Irving Trust Company, and they had what was a classic credit training program. You really went to school with the bank for about a year, taking what were the equivalent of business school classes. They had professors from Darden that were up in New York, and you went to school every day from 9 to 5 for about a year, and then you got placed in the bank. And I was applying for graduate school after, you know, my first year being placed in the bank. I was doing credit analysis on financial institutions. And I got called by a headhunter to interview at Drexel Burnham to join the high-yield bond business as a young salesman in their high-yield commercial paper department. And so the job basically paid what a post-MBA job would pay. And so I decided to put off business school and go take that job. And so I went and took that job, and I worked at Drexel for 4.5 years until Drexel went out of business. But it was an interesting experience. Saw a lot of good, saw a lot of bad, which is why Drexel's not here. And then I wound up at Bear Stearns, no pattern developing. I'd say the business environment, you know, Wall Street was really coming into its own. It was a little bit more open and entrepreneurial, and I was having a big impact. And Bear Stearns was a very open place, and it was really people who were successful in bringing business to the firm got more power and authority in the organization. And so by the mid '90s, at Bear Stearns, in my mid-30s, I was running the investment banking business there. Now, just to put that in perspective, much smaller business than what investment banking was here, but I kind of rose up in that organization, and I got to the management committee of Bear Stearns, and I kind of thought I would stay there, but then was competing with a guy named John Winkelried, who now runs TPG, but he, at one point, he was the co-president of the firm, you know, here. We were competing for a piece of business. The piece of business was to finance Sheldon Adelson in Las Vegas. And when he was building the Venetian and really starting to build his business empire. And at the end of that, John Winkelried turned to me and said, you should come to Goldman Sachs. And, you know, after about 6 months of to-ing and fro-ing, I was 37 at the time, I was really committed and believed that I was a big organization person. I really saw the benefits of being a part of a big organization. I had lots of opportunities to go do entrepreneurial things or work in smaller things, and I really loved the big organizational dynamic, and I said, if I'm going to do this, and this is where my career is going, you know, why not play for the Yankees? And so I went.
So how do you think about, I mean, obviously a lot of storied institutions that you've been at before, how do you compare them to Goldman, but maybe more focus on what do you think makes Goldman different and special, and why do you think that, we're going to be able to have maybe a bigger impact in the world than some of those prior places?
You know, I think the big differentiator of this organization is the quality of the people that it attracts, continues to attract, continues to retain. And importantly, you know, if we really put clients at the center of everything we do and we really recognize that we run a client franchise, and the more we can put ourselves in our client's shoes and really experience the world through their eyes and their experiences, the better we'll be at serving them. And if we do that well, you know, we'll do just fine. And you know, there'll be bumps and there'll be dents and there'll be, you know, things that we have to wrestle with like all institutions. But I think we're in a really privileged place. And look, these financial firms, what do they have at the end of the day? They have people, they have technology, and they have capital. And the capital is definitely a commodity. There's plenty of it in the world. You know, the technology, there's some of it that's commodity, but there's some of it that's differentiated. I think we've proven that we can build platforms that add a lot of value. We've done that over a long period of time, and so that's a core strength. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, people and talent and how you're able to attract, retain them, and allow them to thrive in an organization. And I think we're differentiated versus people we compete with.
Obviously, your strategy has been a number of different shifts, probably a little more focused on a shift into the consumer. Can you talk a little bit about some of that shift from Goldman Sachs as core, you know, white shoe investment bank into moving into more of a bank focused, more of a commercial bank, and some of that strategy around our pivot?
You know, look, at the core, we're an institutional firm, and we've got incredible institutional businesses, but we've got to grow the firm, and to grow the firm, we're reaching into other areas, and the biggest untapped areas, we've got a big global brand, we've never had a big business with consumers, and technology is allowing someone like us to be more of a disruptor in those businesses that had only a handful of significant players, and so we're definitely moving in that direction. I think we're trying to broaden the products and services that we offer to all our clients, and technology is really the tool that allows us to do that. I think, look, if you look at the great disruptive businesses that have made progress that touch consumers, one of the reasons they've done well is because consumers love them. You know, there's a big debate about Amazon and Amazon's place in the world, but makes your life easier, makes things cheaper, makes things more accessible. It's fascinating that nobody's ever really taken an approach that looks like that toward finance. You know, finance and personal finance is still something that's very analog. It's very bespoke. It's very localized, and you have very little information really available to you in an integrated way to help you make good decisions, whether you're saving money, whether you're borrowing money, whether you're investing money, whether you're buying insurance. It's all not integrated in a meaningful way. So there's a great opportunity to disrupt that and change that, and we were in a very, very interesting place because we knew that we had to build a deposit platform because strategically we had to change our funding mix. And obviously, if you want to take in deposits now, you wouldn't start going and building branches. You'd try to do it digitally. And so, you know, we decided to build a digital platform. We started kind of reimagining what a digital banking platform could look like over time and how it could integrate all this functionality. And so we're well on our way. But if we started this and it was out in Silicon Valley and we were in our 20s instead of in our 50s, and we accomplished what we've accomplished, $50 billion of online deposits, 4 million customers. We've built the first credit card platform in 20 years. It's I think, in a position where there's some better security aspects to it, but certainly better usability, application, less friction for users. You know, people would be funding us at $25 billion and talking about it, yeah, you know, as a high-flying unicorn. It's just a very, very interesting dichotomy because I think there's this view that the only way you can disrupt is to be an outsider and to be in a startup kind of business. But I think the best disruptors often in second stage disruption can be existing businesses.
Yeah. Sustainability has been something that's a key tenet, I'd say, of your early tenor. And I know we've spoken a lot about how we can better incorporate that and integrate that into the firm and the things that we're doing. What does sustainability mean to you when you think about it in a number of the different sleeves? I mean, I think there's the diversity component, there's the sort of the green component. How do you think about sustainability and making an impact on the world?
Sure. So sustainability is a big broad word, and we use the word consciously because it allows you to talk about, you know, our impact in the broadest sense, our impact as a business, our impact for our employees, our impact in the communities that we operate, our impact in the world. And, you know, and obviously when people talk about sustainability, they immediately go to the environment, but as you rightfully point out, you know, there are a whole bunch of things that we're extremely focused on. We're focused on economic sustainability. We're focused on the sustainability of a free market system and capitalism that works and is, you know, fair and broad and brings people along and creates more opportunity for people. We're focused on sustainability around the environment, and we're focused on sustainability in our communities.
Okay, so let's pivot and talk about our summer interns for
sure.
A minute. So coming out of school now, in this particular moment, they have more choices than ever about where they can be, the fields they can go into. A lot of them are tech savvy, have engineering backgrounds. Coding is becoming a very common but desirable skill. You know, the question that a lot of summer people ask me is, if you were coming out of school now, would you come to Goldman Sachs and why? Or what other places would you look at and consider?
Sure. I mean, if I was coming out of school, I would absolutely come to Goldman Sachs. I tried to go to Goldman Sachs. I mean, I told you about one of the times I interviewed, and then I tried again. I would absolutely come. And look, it's got to be put through the lens. What are you trying to accomplish when you come out of school and you're going to work? You're not, again, this is progress versus perfection. You're not trying to find the perfect job. You're not trying to know exactly what you want to do for your whole career. You're trying to get some experience, get an education, meet some people, start to build a network, start to understand what you like or you don't like about work, professional life opportunity. What better place to do it than in an organization that is filled with world-class super smart people, that has a great reputation for training and developing people, that brands you and opens up opportunities for you to do lots of other things, whether inside or outside of Goldman Sachs. It's a great place to start your career and build your career. For some of you, you'll fall in love with the place and you'll build a career here. For others, you'll say, you know what? I'm more interested in this because I've gotten this experience, and you'll go in a different direction. But I know there are very few that come here and spend time here, whether it's 2 years, 10 years, or 25 years, that don't leave feeling good about this organization.
So any advice for them as they're nearing the end of the summer when they think about starting their career path, hopefully here at Goldman Sachs, but other places as well? What do you think is sort of the key to making it, to that longevity, to the success that you've had?
Yeah, well, ultimately, you've got to find something that you're passionate or interested in. But you don't have to find that, you know, day one. It's a marathon. It's not a sprint. You know, there are, everybody's always in a hurry for the next, you know, for the next thing. One of the best pieces of advice, somebody asked me recently in one of these interviews, what's the best piece of advice you ever got? I was kind of like, and then I thought about it for a minute, and I said, actually, my grandmother, when I was in my young 20s, said to me, don't be in a hurry. And she said it, you know, in a very, very, you know, don't be in a hurry. And I think it's really good advice. Don't be in a hurry. It's a journey. And you know, it's a long road, and so this is just a start. Don't be in a hurry. You know, affiliate yourself with people that you like, that you respect, that you think you can learn from. You know, ask questions, be open, see how you feel, and don't make decisions based on how you feel for a month or two. Make decisions based on how you feel for a year or two. You know, someone who works here, who's still working here, came to me a few years ago. She came to me looking for advice. And she said, I'm trying to figure out what I should do next. And I said, okay. And I knew she had been in her job for about 9 months. I said, okay, well, before we talk about what you should do next, let's talk about your current job. How's it going? Oh, great. I said, you like the job? Oh, I love it. The work is super fascinating. I was like, well, that's good. How's your boss? Oh, I'm working for this woman who's absolutely fabulous. She's teaching me, she makes time for me, I really feel like I'm getting mentored. She's absolutely fantastic. Don't think I could have a better boss. Great, how about the people you're working with? Incredible, super smart, we go out on the weekends, we have fun, I've made friends. I really love these people. This, so far, this is the best group of people I've worked with in the firm. I said, go back to work and just enjoy that. You have this moment, you know, in the solar system where, you know, everything's working. Just, you know, enjoy the ride a little bit. Don't be so worried about what's next.
Yeah.
And so just, you know, just take a breath. It's a long road.
Great.
Thank you guys all. I hope you've had a great summer. Appreciate it. Good luck with everything.
Thank you very much. Great.